And here to discuss synthetic biology research at the Biodesign Institute is once again its director, George Poste. Also in studio is Brad Allenby, a professor of civil and environmental engineering at the Ira A. Fulton School of Engineering. Professor Allenby is a former director of energy and environmental systems at Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory. And joining us via satellite from New York City is J. Craig Venter, president of the J. Craig Venter Institute based in Rockville, Maryland. Dr. Venter and his research teams are pioneers in genomic research, having successfully mapped the human genome in 2001. Thank you all for being here, and we'll begin with you, Dr. Venter. Obviously, you're known for your work with the human genome. Talk about the relevance of synthetic biology to that work.
Well, in fact, the human genome, in fact, what we've just published of the first human diploid genome, the complete genome of one individual, is sort of the accumulation of this era for the last decade and a half of digitizing biology. So we can go from DNA to DNA sequence to the computer. Now with synthetic biology and synthetic genomics, we can go in the other direction of taking sequence out of the computer, chemically writing the genetic code, as an example, to come up with new organisms, new approaches to biology. And also with the human genome, we have about 100 trillion cells in our bodies, and yet with the simplest bacteria with maybe even 500 genes, we don't fully understand the biology of those single cells. So with the synthetic biology and synthetic genomic approaches, it gives us a chance to really, truly dissect biology to its most intimate level for the first time, I think, in biological history.
And sort of taking things to the next step, it seems.
And taking it to, obviously, stepping up the pace of evolution, taking over from the evolutionary process of billions of years and converting it into weeks, months, or years will be a big change.
And George, talk a little bit about the work being done here and making that connection.
Well, what Craig has outlined is the fact that we're really looking at the basic control systems of cellular life. And the simplest but nonetheless highly sophisticated life forms are bacteria. And although they might seem to be a long way distant from us in evolutionary time, they're extraordinarily sophisticated, and many of the control systems they use to control their genes are identical to those that we use. The great advantage, as Craig said a moment ago, is that they're simpler. There are only about 500 genes. The pioneering work that Craig and his colleagues have been doing is to try and create something called the minimal genome. What is the minimum number of genes that a cell needs to survive? Then the whole purpose of synthetic biology is being able to add additional genes, often as cassettes, because these genes carry out related functions. And the essence of synthetic biology in modifying microorganisms, which is where synthetic biology is starting, is to, as we saw in one of the other programs, to create organisms capable of cleaning up the environment, to create organisms capable of carrying out very complex synthetic processes that don't deplete natural resources, and increasingly a focus in using them as a novel source for alternative energy, which again Craig has been a pioneering.
Mm-hmm. And Brad, talk a little bit about the idea of creating these organisms from scratch. Why, you know, people might ask why, about the necessity of that.
Well, I think there's a couple of answers to that. One reason, obviously, is that evolution occurs based on previous life forms. So if you have functions that you need to perform that do not fit within where evolution was going, you've got to design your own. You really have no choice. The second is that evolution designs things for different reasons than we do. A lot of the bugs that we're creating are designed for, as George and Craig have said, health reasons, very specific economic reasons within human systems. And evolution is not tuned to producing
that
kind of organism. Absolutely.
Right. And Craig, talk a little bit about the advantages from your perspective of using synthetic biology. You know, people think of the excitement behind creating new drugs, heading in different directions. Kind of give us where you think it might go.
I think the challenge all along has been to try and harness the knowledge and the power of biology. And we've been looking at, historically, lots of organisms as a scientific field. And just to build on the last point, you know, there's organisms out there that produce the equivalent of diesel fuel of hydrogen, of basically any fuel we can think of, methane and as a source of natural gas. But no organisms that we know of evolved to produce the kind of quantities that we consume in using energy. So we need to apply additional resources where we can maybe change metabolism by as much as 1,000-fold is certainly one direction to go. But if you just think of the concept of design, we now have discovered about 10 million genes. And we think of these genes as the design components of biology. And if we could sit down at the computer and design cells to solve problems, whether it's to make combinatorial antibodies, to create new vaccines, to create new biological fuels or chemical synthesis, it takes us into a design phase of biology versus just an observer and a cataloger.
And I think building on that, what we refer to as directed evolution. So this remarkable diversity that's evolved over 4 billion years of evolution has equipped bugs to live in literally any environment. Everywhere we look, we're surprised by new organisms turning up, as we discussed in one of the other programs, to live in truly extreme environments like the deep ocean vents that we saw, toxic waste dumps and so forth. Understanding how those organisms do that, we can not only take particular molecules out of the bugs, but also then take that molecule and in the laboratory produce millions of variants of that protein, as you saw in John Chaput's piece on the video, and therefore we're accelerating evolution. Biology sort of stopped always when it's optimum for what was the natural selection pressure. The natural selection pressure we may need for an industrial process is entirely different, as Brad said, to what happens in the natural world. So the ability to build millions of variants and screen them quickly gives you the chance to actually leapfrog over natural evolution.
And I think it's important to understand that what this does is this creates more option spaces. And in a period of very rapid technological, economic, and environmental change, what you really need to be able to obtain resilience in the overall system is option spaces. And that's what you're getting with synthetic biology.
And I think we're going to, let me finish up with you, Craig, because I'm sure you get this question. We just have about 30 seconds left. But dealing with the ethical questions that come up, there's certainly excitement about all of this, but at the same time, you have to keep the ethical considerations in mind. And again, we're just wrapping up here.
Well, in fact, that's something we've looked at from the beginning before we did the first experiments. And it's an ongoing discussion, but we think it is critical. For example, should we design things that should be released into the environment? Our initial view is no, without understanding things a lot better. But this is probably the field that has had more ethical discussion before the first experiments were done than any other field in scientific history.
Very good. Great information. And Dr. Venter, Dr. Allenby, Dr. Poste, thank you very much. Fascinating topic and informative discussion. Thank you for joining us for this edition of ASU Spotlight on the Biodesign Institute. If you'd like to learn more about this fascinating topic, you can go online to biodesign.asu.edu. That's biodesign.asu.edu. I'm Carrie Pfeffer. Thanks for watching.